Hello, ladies and gentlefolk, and welcome to another video. Now, how did this sorry story start? A friend of mine was visiting, and he, back in the day, was an Amiga fan. He's talking about getting another Amiga, but given that he is now retired, I don't know whether he will. The prices of a lot of the retro hardware are still utterly through the roof, and yeah, I managed to get the Amiga emulation system working on my Mister, so we decided to give it a run and see if he could play some of his old games that he used to back in the day, like Flood, the Chaos Engine, things like that. And he was playing using this, which is the system that I created, you know, buttons, shoulder buttons, yada yada, all the rest of it. But he found it difficult, and he said he couldn't play using this. He needed to play using one of the joysticks of old. As previously mentioned, retro equipment prices have been through the roof, but I managed to find these, which are Quickshot 2 joysticks made for the NES. Now, they were a reasonable price of about £20 each, delivered, which I thought was worth taking a risk on, because I've never exactly been inside one of these. And if you know, 9 inputs or 9 wires across a 7-pin plug means that there's a controller in there. So I didn't know how far I'd get or what the result would be. This is one of them open, and I've been working on it. There's 3 screws to the handle itself. That comes off, and as you can see, pretty much everything is the old rubber trigger, whereby you have, if I take this off, you'll see you've got an interleaved section of contacts here, and inside there is a contact substance of various types, which bridges, when pressed against this, bridges the contacts and makes the circuit. Let's just try and put that back on there. There were 2 primary methods that were commonly used on these kinds of things, which is this system and also microswitches. Try and get this back in there now. There, it'll go. And the longevity and maintenance of the 2 types, well, they come with their own quirks, lifespan, and with these, as long as the rubber hasn't perished, you can typically paint a new substance inside to bridge the gap if you need to. And occasionally you need to take them off and clean the grids themselves. But all in all, it's a reasonably reliable contact system. Whereas with microswitches, it's getting a bit more of a problem these days, because some of the microswitches are starting to get to be hard to find, to be perfectly honest. So when I opened this up and found this contact method used throughout the joystick, I wasn't too displeased. At least I stand a chance of keeping this working for many years to come, I hope. But the key thing was, what was I going to do? How was I going to fit one of these in here, which is a Pro Micro Arduino, basically based on a chip, and running Daemon Bytes software, it will turn it turns this into a joystick controller. Basically, I worked out that this board sits on here and is supported quite well, which gives us space to actually put this underneath, and I think it'll be going here in the long haul. That's where it will be going, with the USB cable coming out there. I'll tie it around here. That's interesting, that must be just support. I'll run it through here, tie it off against this more solid post, and then out here, and that should be enough to keep it. This board will then go down on top of it, and it should all work. If I take a bit more care out of this, oh dear, I've just lost one of the cables. which one is this. That's a bit of soldering work that I've got to redo. Oh joy, this is actually right. So I took all the components off, including the chip that was here doing the controlling, and basically soldered everything through. So basically with that sat there, with the pins actually gone sideways, if you know what I mean, like that, it gives it enough of a profile, low profile, that it will sit beneath the board. So the board should be able to come down. I need to do this damn sight more carefully. The board will come down, sit here, and that will happily sit there with the Arduino, the Pro Micro underneath it. And then that can fit in, and the whole thing can be sat, can be reassembled. So there is there's quite a bit of room in there, as you can hopefully see if you can peek down the bottom there. There's quite a bit of room for all this to happen, and all I've got to do is make sure that I get these contacts right and that they're going to survive. So that's a bit more, and then I can just reassemble the thing. So yeah, just got to redo that one and we are good to go. Just take a bit more care. As you can see, everything is bent over with covers of the cables themselves. I've taken the covers off, soldered them in to the pins, because obviously the pins are bent, they're not full length pins anymore. Soldered them in and just isolated, put some isolating tape between some of the connections. Now obviously, what do you say, I'm gonna have to put some sticky. I've got to wait to see the cables. I've had to order some 3 meter USB micro USB cables, and I'll either have to anchor, glue down the plug there, or glue down this here with some pads. I'll have to see what happens, how I get it in there, and what mechanism I use to glue it, but pretty much it's going to work, is all I can say. I've already tested it, it works fine. Just redo that solder joint and I'll be good to go. So it was a case of clean up all the contacts, make the holes where the chip was, and then poke these through and then resolder them. So I've got a bit more work to do. Yeah, all using relatively standard tools. One thing that I am using these days are 2x glasses. They're not the best, but I had to cut a section of these off so that they would fit on my nose in front of my normal glasses in order for me to actually see what I was doing. Yeah, my eyesight's getting a bit bad these days, and I've not long, I'm only just the wrong side of 50. So yeah, so it's all happening, it's going to work. It's just a case of get it all soldered and a bit more stable, and it'll all be happy. So there you go. I might record a video doing this quick shot now that I actually know what I'm doing, but to be honest, there's nothing much to it, really. Yeah, I obviously had to take this apart in order to work out what was going on. The orange cable is linked to the autofire, but if the autofire is on, obviously it won't work. I think that there was some sort of oscillating signal coming up from the chip, which is going up, and you were either having the straight signal on red or the oscillating signal on orange. But although I could actually use the 5-volt supply on the Pro Micro to generate such a signal, it's not really worth it. It's not really worthwhile for the extra grief that it'll cause. I'll just be happy to get this working as it is. So there you go, another little project, and another piece of retro hardware that was going to just live a life of obscurity is now going to have another lease of life. Obviously, exactly what I'm going to do with this I don't know, because yeah, I wouldn't have been able, I might not have been able to get that over the USB cable, as it's going to come in anyway. So tying off the USB cable to here is probably going to be the more sensible option for me. So there you go. I'll catch you on the next video. Ciao for now.